Okay, this shouldn't take too long anyway, because I think last week's homework should have been rather quick. So just let me share my screen here. Okay, so first of all, last week's homework. We had this new data set where we were supposed to explore factors for fuel efficiency in cars based on the cars data set, which we have already looked at actually. Okay, these were really, really quick exercises, I think, and I really hope you didn't have much problems with that. Because you could basically just copy code from the lecture, changing the respective data sets. So first of all, simple linear regression predicting miles from gallon from horsepower, but without the formula interface, but with Patsy such that we return the design matrix as well as the regression result. If we wouldn't have done this with Patsy, but with the formula interface, we only would get the we wouldn't get the design matrix. The two design matrices. How do we do this? Well, we simply look into the lecture, look at the half automated way, and we see that Patsy simply we can get the D matrices using Patsy.D matrices, and then we could simply use sm.ols using the respective design matrices from Patsy. So if you want to know why again, why we're doing this here, it's the pseudo inverse, and I again refer to the new informatics lecture, why this makes sense to take the pseudo inverse and why we need the inverse for a regression anyway. We're just using this. So what we're doing here is, well, we simply use Patsy here for. So we simply write it like this. But we don't have y and x, but instead we have miles per gallon from horsepower, and we use the cars data set. And then afterwards, we plug that into stats models, and we want to return the regression result. So this I will simply copy here from the sample solution because there are only two lines and we're just turning everything. So like this. Like I said, it should be really quick, simply plugging the new data set into what we have. Then the multiple regression, that one was even quicker in my opinion, because now we could use the formula interface, and we want to predict miles per gallon from horsepower, weight in pounds, and origin. We don't even consider interactions. I thought we considered interactions. So if we don't even consider interactions, we can simply add all this stuff here, and we can simply write. And we can simply write. Oops. So we can simply directly return that's models formula.ols, and then inside this we write that we want the miles per gallon, and then from whatever we had, horsepower plus all the others, and that's already it. Yeah, weight in pounds and origin. So this is what we're returning. And that's already it, 7 points. So as you see, this homework was rather quick anyway, so it only gives 15 points, which I think is more than fair. And in the last one we had the bootstrapping. which is what we also did in the lecture. So here we're not using stats models, but we're using bootstrapping to resample. We could have used stats models, but the bootstrapping one, we want to understand what's doing there. We want to have this data-driven approach, and the data-driven approach is basically bootstrapping. So what we're doing is, so we have the data set where we have, where we only look at the cars with 8 cylinders and the one with 6 cylinders, and we see that we have a bunch of samples for the respective cars. And now we want to look at the difference of means of the miles per gallon variable. So we basically only consider the cylinders and the miles per gallon column, and we want to bootstrap, that is, we want to resample the miles per gallon based on the number of cylinders. And what we're doing for this is we're making two groups, and so we resample the two groups individually. The 8 cylinders one we resample from all the ones we have with 8 cylinders, and the 6 cylinders one we resample from all the cars with 6 cylinders. And then what we're doing is we're calculating the difference of mean of the two groups. So when we are bootstrapping, what we are doing is, so in the example we did in the lecture, is that we, inside bootstrapping, so we resampled, and then we made a fit using stats models on our resampled data, and whatever the problem, so, and then we extract the parameter which we are fitting using our normal ordinary least squares method, so the intercept or x or whatever, so intercept or slope basically, and that then we add to our list of samples, and this is then our sampling distribution. For this task, we are not using stats models to get the estimated parameter like the slope or the intercept from our bootstrap samples, but instead the only thing we want to have is the difference of means, which is the effect size. So this here is how to get the sampling distribution, but how to get it for one parameter. And if we look at the effect size, well, the effect size is, okay, yeah, of course, it's also the slope, but the effect size here is defined as the difference of means. Because we have basically categorical variables, and in that case it doesn't make sense. So if we have two categories, then of course the slope doesn't make sense, or rather the slope is obviously dependent on the difference of means, because you go only from the one to the other with this, so there's a difference, an x difference of one between the two groups, and a y difference, which is the difference of means. So calculating the slope is possible and gets to the same, so it, we could do that with stats models and that would lead to the same result, but it's kind of obvious that the slope, if we define the distance between these two categories, the x distance, as one, then the slope is simply the difference of means. So we don't need to calculate that using stats models, but we can simply take the difference of the two means. All right, and then we do this with 1,000 samples, and we basically copy that from the lecture. So what are we copying? Well, we are copying the get sample distribution here, but inside this we don't do this OLS, but we simply append to our samples, we only append the difference of means, and we are resampling twice here. So what we are doing is basically for this param, what is formula here? We don't care for formula because this we also don't take. Num samples is 1000, yes. And then we have resampled 6 and we sampled 8, and they are data.sample, but we don't want data, but we want data where position data cylinder equals 6. And like this too. And we do the same thing here, only for air cylinders. And then we don't do it like this, but samples at the position E equals, we sampled 6 dot mean minus we sampled 8 dot mean. Something like this. In the sample solution I have it a bit prettier. So you can also query pandas data frames, because pandas data frames purposely behave just like databases, like SQL databases, so we can simply query them just like a SQL database. So this has the same effect as this one. And then yes, this is the effect size. Oh yeah, I didn't take the miles per gallon here. And that's then is our sampling distribution. And oh yeah, we didn't only return we didn't only return this mean here. This doesn't make much sense, but we simply add, so we simply calculate the sampling distribution. These here are our new samples, and from this then we calculate the sampling distribution. How do we calculate? Wait, no, where am I? This is where we sample. So this is the get sampling distribution part. This I already had in the other one. Yeah, we simply calculate the effect size from the whole thing. We're supposed to return that. Ah, okay. So the effect size, of course, we don't do for the individual resampled samples, but from the whole groups, because, well, this is the effect size. Sorry, I said it before. So the effect size of the number of cylinders we don't do in our resampling, but simply once as the difference of mean of the two groups, which is what we're doing here. So I should return this here as well. And then this the sampling error is then the standard deviation of the sampling distribution. So right here, this is the, so this we don't do like this, but instead, no, we do. And then afterwards, where we do the same thing as here, so we calculate the standard error as the sampling distribution dot standard deviation, and then we're only missing the confidence intervals. So this here is the prettier way, so let me just copy this code. Okay, so we are making our individual new things to sample from, then we calculate the effect size on the whole data set, because this is what we're returning here as effect size, because for the effect size we don't want to be dependent on our bootstrapping, because the effect size is something of our data set. And this is best calculated, of course, by our data set. But then we said that the sampling error is the same thing as the standard deviation of the sampling distribution. And this is how we want to calculate it. We could have calculated this one not using the sampling distribution, but directly with stats models. We don't do that here because we wanted to use bootstrapping. So what we are doing is we're getting the sampling distribution. And what is the sampling distribution? Well, the sampling distribution is simply the distribution of whatever we want to calculate, which is here the difference of means, aka the effect size, for the bootstrap samples. And bootstrap samples are how calculated, where we simply draw with replacing from our original data set, or in this case data sets, because we do that individually for the 6 cylinders and for the 8 cylinders one. And this is then our sampling distribution, and then the standard error, the sampling error, is the standard deviation of the sampling distribution. And then that's almost it. But additionally, we want to calculate the left and right boundaries of the confidence interval. And this is also in the framework of bootstrapping. And in the framework of bootstrapping, this is simply this. So the confidence intervals are quantify the uncertainty due to the sampling error. And how do we calculate them? Well, they're simply the left and right percentiles of the sampling distribution of the appropriate sizes. So what we're doing is here, we still use our sampling distribution, and we are simply calculating what is at your 2.5 and at your 97.5 percentile. And this is simply this function. I think we can simply one-to-one copy this. Oh yeah, it's, I already copied it in here, because I'm in the solution here. But yeah, we can simply one-to-one copy this. I think, yeah, and it's the precise same thing. And so we simply use this to calculate the left and right boundaries of the confidence interval, and with that we are done. And we simply return the effect size, standard error, left and right borders. All right. So this here is the original one, and this here is the solution. Oh wow, there are more than one people here, more than one person. To your question, wouldn't our sampling distribution actually consist of two distributions? Well, no, because our sampling distribution is the distribution of our, and then we always say it's sample mean. The sampling distribution, in this case we don't want the mean, but we want something else, aka the difference of means. So the sampling distribution is whatever, so for each sample we calculate whatever we want to have. So we boil our sample down to one number, and then our sampling distribution is the distribution of this one number. The distribution of a statistic, and this a statistic can be the difference of means based on various samples of the same distribution. And only because we are calculating a statistic in our sampling distribution, this is subject to the central limit theorem. So only if we calculate some statistics in for every sample that we draw, if we are drawing from bootstrap sample, like no matter what we're drawing from, then we have this one distribution. So no, we don't have two, but we have to take how's it called in NumPy? If you boil down, aggregation. Yes, the sampling distribution is the distribution of the difference of means in this case, yes. Okay, are there more questions? I can always also ask to the lecture content. I'm sorry for this lecture. I think I made a rather bad job on this lecture. And also it's quality wise, it was a bit bad. So I'm sorry for this. But if you have any questions about this here, I'm happy to answer them if I can. Samples of equal size, because the x and y do you mean, because the 6 and the 8 cylinders data sets basically are of different size? That's a good question. So the thing is that if we resample, so I think because when we are, so when we are resampling and then calculating some statistics, it, as we see here in the central limit theorem, it doesn't matter which shape the statistics Fourier had. So the question is, if we are calculating, no, that's not the question, because this is a population distribution. I don't know, but I don't think it does. So what's different is the width of the respective distribution. So if we resample from a smaller data set, then the width of the resulting distribution, so not the difference of means here, but only the width of the means of this one distribution is smaller than the width of the other one. And if we then take the difference of that, then this will be, well, it only affects basically the standard error of the distribution of means then, right? And then basically again, if one, if we have two different distributions then, and one has a higher standard deviation than the other one, this will simply say that the standard deviation of then subtracting the mean of each has a mean which is probably in the, has a standard deviation which is probably in the middle of those two, but that doesn't affect the normality. So it will probably, I would say it doesn't affect the normality, it will only affect the standard error or the width of the distribution, but that doesn't matter. But I can only think about that, like try to think about that myself. Okay, good. So if you have any other questions, I can try to answer them as well. But then let me just continue, because I also need to be gone in a few minutes because I have another conference call. Let me talk about this homework. And in this homework you only have one task with 25 points, which I hope is fine for you, but there are only three people maximally left which need the points for the homework. So even if you only, so you cannot get partial points here, but this shouldn't matter too much for most of you, because most of you don't need the points anyway. And if you think you will, I encourage you to look at the dashboard again. And yes, in this homework, we are doing a complete task from start to finish. So this task, I think a psychology student friend of mine once did this in MATLAB or something stupid, and I simply ported the code for that to experiment the way I saw fit, and this is why we are left with this task. So it's the Sternberg task, and the Sternberg task simply asks the questions, how do we search in our short-term memory? And then it has three hypotheses how we could search. First of all, we could search in parallel, meaning that if we memorize, for example, a sequence of number, then all items of that sequence we take, so if we search in parallel, that means that for all items of that sequence, we would search the same length on average. So no matter if it was the first, the last, or some item in the middle, we are recalling that item, all items roughly at the same time. And the other hypothesis is that, well, the alternative to the search being parallel is our search is serial, meaning that items are recalled one after the other. This doesn't mean serial in the order of the items as they occurred. It could be the reverse based, so it could be encoding based forward or backward, or in any arbitrary order. Maybe we're remembering items in the order 2, 7, 6, 5, 1, 3, 4. It doesn't matter. this is not what the task says, but that basically for the Xth item, we on average search shorter than for the Yth item. And now this has two sub theories, and that is self-terminating recall or exhaustive recall. Self-terminating recall means that as soon as we find the entry, we end our search. So if we are remembering the items 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we're looking for the item 2, then we're going through on shorter memory like 1, 2, 2, okay, I can return 2. And there's also the possibility that the search could be exhaustive. So if we're searching for 2, we're going 1, 2, oh, there was a 3, 4, 5, but there was a 2 in between. This doesn't sound too plausible, but it's definitely a possibility we have to consider. And then the Steinberg task tries to check which of these hold by this experimental setup, and we show 1 to 6 numbers. There's the magical number, what was the name? The magical number 7. The magical number 7. I think it was called because this is, yeah, the magical number 7. So the theory is that our shorter memory can contain up to 7 numbers, plus minus 2. So we are presenting 1 to 6 numbers to, because you also have to show a 7th, to memorize the 7th number. So that's why we have 6 numbers. So we're presenting 1 to 6 numbers, one after another in a random order. Then we show a single number, and then afterwards the subject has to tell if the last number was part of the sequence from before. This looks then like this. So this is a screen recording of the task as I did it. So we're seeing a sequence of number. I think that was only one number. So we saw the 7, and then we asked the question, is 7 in there? And we're showing this sequence of 6 numbers, is the maximum length, and then the target is 5, and we have to answer the question if the 5 was in there. Okay, and then we analyze this with the following hypotheses, and that is, if the recall process was parallel, there would be no increase or a jump increase in response time depending on the number of elements in our sequence. If the recall process was serial and self-terminating, then there are two possibilities. Either the number we looked for is part of the sequence, then we would search up to this number, which could be the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, or sixth element, and on average is the third element. So on average, for the case that the number we're looking for is part of our sequence, we're searching through 3 elements. But for the case where the number is not part of our sequence, we are always looking through all our items, which are on average 6, where the average I just said is depending on the length of the sequence. But we see that we have either, so in 50% of cases we're looking through the entire sequence, which is of length 1 to 6, and in 50% of cases we're looking through only half on average of the sequence. So on average we do have a longer response time for longer sequences, but this response time is not linear to the number of elements because of the fact that 50% of cases we're not searching through all elements. So we have a not too steep slope. And if the recall process was serial and exhaustive, then we'd have linear increases every item, because then, well, for the 6-element sequence, we would always search through all 6 items, no matter if the element was the first or the 6th element, because we're always going through all 6. No matter if the item was there or not, or no matter if the number of the item. Okay, and from this we are creating the Steinberg task using an experiment. So 132 trials, 12 practice trials, and then 2 blocks of 60 trials each. In between those there's always a pause, and then what we're doing is we're showing 1 to 6 consecutive digits, 1200 milliseconds per second for digit, then widescreen, then fixed cross, widescreen, and then the target digit. And these numbers you all, so these numbers are the precise numbers which we are using in the experiment, so which is why I wrote them down that precise. But we see that I used the numbers already in the conduct experiment method, so you don't have to use these numbers in the make design. And then, so yes, either click Y or N, and so it goes on. So this is then the complete task description. Like I said, the general frame for conducting the experiment is already here. And like I said, always in experiment, we are looping over the blocks. And in for, so we go for block in blocks, and then inside of the blocks we go for trial in block.trials, and then inside of this we, in this case, because we are showing the numbers, the stimuli consecutively, we are looping then also over the stimuli of each trial. And then, well, depending on number here, I'm making the instructions pause and pause in between. And then I'm using here, for example, inside this, I'm using get factor does appear. So you see that get factor does appear. We need to have a factor for our trials, which is named does appear. And this controls if the number shown afterwards was part of the sequence or not. So apparently in your make design function, you have to set for trials a factor named does appear. So this is, and yeah, then you're doing the make design function. So I am not testing the conduct experiments. So if you do the design the way I expected you to do it, which I hope I wrote precise enough here, and I don't test the conducting the experiment, I'm only testing the resulting CSV that drops out of your design. And it makes sense to run the task continually if you do this, and it also makes sense to look at the test, to look at what I'm testing here, because I'm really, so the test here is really saying a lot, I think, because when it also shows what are the names of the variable that are occurring here, and how many practice trials do we have, etc., etc., what are the names of our blocks. So this test should be rather verbose in testing what it's testing. The order of the testing doesn't make much sense necessarily here, but you should run into hopefully obvious enough error messages if you are wrong. And then yes, in the end you have a full Sternberg task, and that then you can analyze, I think. So this week 14 study related questions won't exist in the final version of this lecture, because we don't have 14 weeks this semester, we only have 13 weeks. So next week Philip is going to talk about speed ups. So actually not quite sure what he does. So normally, so the normal stuff, multiprocessing, multithreading, but Python has many nice libraries to well, make your code faster without doing explicitly, oh shit, I have the, oh no, oops, okay, I may have the samples, oh shit, you didn't just see that I have the sample solution in this week, oh shit, I didn't delete this. Okay, please don't copy the code from the lectures repository. Oh shit, I should have deleted this. Well, whatever. Where was I? Philip will do speedups next week, which is not necessarily multiprocessing and multithreading, because Python has really many third-party libraries which just make your code faster by simply adding decorators to functions. without any thinking about it, and this scales up really nicely because they're really nice libraries by now. So this is what's next week, and then I don't have this study aid to that lecture. I won't show this, but it's here. It will be moved to this left out lectures directory here, and I will remove the experiment code for this. Oh shit, I didn't think about deleting this. And then we also have here, and then we're also going through interpretation. So, and then here I also, so like I said, the study was conducted by a psychology studying friend of mine, and they have the results of this. The results are not originally from experiment, but from this matplotlib code. I ported them, and here then we're also looking at this. So these are the theoretical one-times, for example, for self-terminating and appears, and for exhaustive and doesn't appear. Self-terminating appears, exhaustive and doesn't appear, etc., etc. Then we have many data sets for the individual students. Then we're working on this using our knowledge of pandas, matplotlib, etc., and also our knowledge here of stats models. And then we even, oh no, this is not the result. Yada 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 yada. Okay, I have to go into the conference call. Yada yada yada. And then we have the result in the end. So this here is where I'm actually doing this complete analysis of the experiment, of the data. So if you are interested in that, how to conduct the study from A to Z, look at this left out lecture. But yes, please don't copy the code, but try to do it yourself. In the first couple of lectures, we're in that as a question, so you have another try. Yes, we do, and I will upload them to YouTube anyway throughout the next weeks. Is it fine if that takes longer than? So that will probably take some time because uploading to YouTube is also a pain in the butt, and I need to get some videos from Philip anyway. So it won't be in the next week, but rather in the next, I don't know, in the course of the next 3 weeks. But I will announce that on Sudapi, that's fine. Okay, so if you have no more questions, I would leave now because I have a conference call in 6 minutes. Yes, doesn't matter too much that the code is here because you should be done anyway, so there are like 3 people who are not done yet. Okay, so if you don't have any questions, I'm gonna leave. Thanks for your attention, and bye bye.